264 of Cinematary. I'm your host, Zach Dennis, and I am here by myself. Logan Kinney and Michael O'Malley are going to be joining me in the second half, but we're kind of just, you know, it's a lot of people from the podcast came back from TIFF. Everybody rightfully is tired. It was a long week. And for the people who did not go to TIFF, they have nothing to say about the movies that they saw. We saw that because, you know, it's a film festival. So I'm going to sit here and I'm going to vamp for a while, I guess, on Cinematary. So this might be a low listen to portion of the podcast. I will just let you know that I will put the, when we start part two time mark in the description, but I'm gonna talk a little bit about some movies that I caught at TIFF that we did not talk about on like the videos and stuff. So if you did not see those, we have three video diaries on our Facebook page, facebook.com/cinematary. We're just kind of recapping stuff that we saw at TIFF, and then we also have the first day episode of TIFF kind of recapping is on the last week's episode in part one, so definitely listen to that. But before we start, I do want to just a massive shout out to Jessica and Andrew for coming. I know I feel kind of guilty as the only person who comes with the press pass, so I have a lot larger range of stuff that I can pick from, and so I appreciate them coming and putting in their money and time and effort to do that. And so, if you know, as they listen, know that it's very much appreciated. And I hope that people take time to check out the reviews and stuff that we'll come up with later in the month coming from this. So before also we start, check out cinematary.com. We got some good reviews of Parasite, which we did not see at TIFF. Parasite and Angel Has Fallen, some good stuff there. And then check out our Patreon. We're gonna have some more Patreon stuff coming up in the next few weeks. So if you did not listen to our latest Film Theory and Chill, it's worth checking out. But let me start our TIFF roundup first with one that I was very skeptical going in, and it did not very much pan out for me, and that is Taika Waititi's Jojo Rabbit. Taika Waititi has been kind of jumping up as somebody to keep an eye on because of his work with Thor Ragnarok. At least it's kind of got him on a much more mainstream level after doing a lot of his films in New Zealand, which those are easily some of my favorites. You have Hunt for the Wilder People, What We Do in the Shadows, Boy, Eagle vs. Shark. A lot of those kind of gained this kind of cult following, and people really enjoyed his brand of comedy. And then of course he went to the big time with Thor Ragnarok, which is fine. It's one of the more entertaining Marvel movies, but at the same time it feels very much a step down from what he was doing in a smaller fare. And so this is supposed to be a return to that smaller fare before he gets on to the next Thor movie. But I guess he was like, we're going to take the sentimentality and cutesiness of my other movies and then drop you into, World War II era Germany and the Nazis. So Jojo Rabbit is about this boy played by Roman Griffin Davis, who earns the name Jojo Rabbit because he elects not to kill a rabbit that is handed to him by these training officers at his Nazi youth camp. But he does have this escapism, or at least this escapist technique, which is he has an imaginary friend who is actually Adolf Hitler, played by the director and writer of the movie himself. Taika Waititi plays this version of Hitler who, I'm trying to think of a good comparison, is just kind of this, you know, I don't know. It doesn't really fall as much in line with, like, I think the comparisons go to, like, The Great Dictator or you have The Great Dictator or The Producers, you know, like Springtime for Hitler. And it's not that in the same way. You know, it's very much Waititi's brand of kind of off-kilter, absurdist to an extent, satirical humor. But, you know, and this is, and I don't feel like I'm breaking ground on this. A lot of the people who felt strongly in the opposed category for this movie kind of feel the same way. But I mean, this is a very loaded topic. This is not necessarily a place that you're going to have to be very careful if you're going to kind of bring that sentimentality. And I think that this is something that I've been thinking a lot about recently in the past few months. But there's a lot that you have to kind of put into when you're going to be putting together a Nazi narrative, especially a satirical Nazi narrative. because I think, and this, again, this is just me, but in 2019, just kind of pointing out, hey, they're Nazis, that's bad. I think at this point, we know that the Nazis are bad. And I think that we know it by seeing the uniforms, by seeing the swastika symbol, by seeing just the kind of figure of Hitler. You see the kind of parted hair, the mustache, you see all those kind of, it's so iconographic. I'm sitting here by myself trying to make up words. It's so based on symbols and such that I feel like it's kind of poking fun at that, but I think we're past that. Like, most people, nobody's like, oh yeah, that's great. Because the concept of the Nazi has kind of almost got itself away from the actual atrocities and the actual acts of the National Socialist Party of Germany, which is again a party built specifically on taking these symbols and concepts that would sound great to the German people, but instilling their own, you know, white supremacist racist ideology behind it. And so, you know, Waititi is having to thread all of that with also his kind of boy meets girl and has a crush on this girl narrative, because as the plot kind of moves on and on, you find out that a girl played by Thomasin McKenzie, who is in Leave No Trace, the Ben Foster movie from last year, is a Jewish girl who has been hiding in their attic. His mother, played by Scarlett Johansson, who I guess saw a Nazi narrative and was like, I can't stay away from that. But she's like, I kind of want to be on the other side, but I guess I'll be the mother for the good for the good people in this one. Pretty much the rest of the movie is him, you know, softening his stance on Nazism as he learns that, that this Jewish girl is a person and that he can have a relationship and connect with her, which, again, is a just, I don't know, to me, that's just a tired concept in 2019. Because, like, what you're doing, again, it goes back to this point that I made. It's you're taking the concept of this symbol of Nazism. It's not, I think that Waititi is trying to make this kind of current point against the kind of current cultural political movement, but it's just not necessarily, it's just pretty toothless, because at the end of the day, what you need to be speaking to in 2019 through this narrative is not, you know, let's kick Hitler and say no to the swastika, because those are two symbols that I don't think correlate with what's happening today. They correlate with this white supremacist group of people in Germany in the late 1930s, 1940s, and it doesn't necessarily correlate to what's happening today, because it's more about the ideology. It's more about the racist white supremacy that kind of forms the foundation of Nazism that you need to be attacking. It's not the whole Nazism thing. And so the reason I say that this movie is relatively toothless is because it's constantly pushing, like, it's like the first movie that's ever made fun of Nazis. And I'm like, no, it's not. I mean, there was this article I saw in the Hollywood Reporter where people are like, is Germany ready to laugh at Hitler? And it's like, no, Germany's been laughing at Hitler for like, since Hitler's been dead. Like, they've been laughing at that guy for a long time. They've fully gotten past that and you know, askew the Nazi imagery. But I don't think that I think that there's just this point with movies that deal with kind of Nazi characters where it's kind of built on this narrative of, like, you got to say no to them. I think at the end, we're like, yeah, of course you're going to say no. Even the people who are practically preaching the same ideology today would say, yeah, no to Hitler. But that, what you're missing the point if you're just saying, let's kick Hitler and that's solving things. And I don't think this is, like, trying to solve anything. It's trying to, like, make, kind of give you this good feeling and make you feel, kind of laugh and make you feel a little bit better in this dark time. And I'm like, no, I don't think that's what we need. I think it needs to kind of suck. It needs to kind of hurt a little bit. It needs to be just pull, you know, pulverizing to an extent, because I think that that's what can lead you to solving these issues. And while art and pop culture is important, I just think that this is such a toothless, I don't hate this movie at all. It's just such a toothless, kind of boring interpretation of 2019 culture that I'm just kind of like, bleh. So Jojo Rabbit, it's coming out later this year. I'll be curious to hear. I'm sure we'll have a longer discussion about it whenever it does come out. The other one I wanted to talk about is The Lighthouse. Andrew was incredibly angry that he couldn't go to this, and I apologize that I was the only person to go to this. It's the latest from Robert Eggers, who, of course, directed The Witch. And it stars Willem Dafoe and Robert Pattinson as these two men who have to spend 4 weeks at this remote New England island in the late 1800s. They're working at this lighthouse. They're lighthouse keepers. Willem Dafoe has definitely been doing this for a long time. And then you have Robert Pattinson's character is kind of a little bit of some fresh blood. He talks a little bit about how he's done a various array of different jobs up to this point, but wanted to kind of get a change of pace, and so he moves on to doing this. And I mean, that's pretty much what you get. The only other plot beat is after 4 weeks, kind of a storm comes in, and so this four week sojourn in this mysterious island in New England becomes a kind of an extended week with these two men as they kind of grow more and more agitated with each other. And I love the Letterboxd review that I think kind of encapsulates, if you don't want to learn too much about this movie but want to be kind of intrigued, and they call it Carl Theodore Dreyer's The Shining, which is a perfect interpretation. This movie's shot in black and white. I was telling Andrew that a lot of the imagery reminds you of, like, and granted I haven't watched like a ton of Dreyer, but it reminds you a little bit just of Vampyr and the kind of ghastly celestial images. It feels both like reality based but has this kind of otherworldly quality to it. It constantly feels like you're almost like on the precipice of like mythology. And compared to The Witch, which is very much based in like this paganism and this witchcraft and this that kind of panic in the early times in America, this one kind of shifts that, where it's more focusing on the kind of nautical folklore and mythology of to that extent. You also have just this kind of descent into madness, not just because you're stuck on this remote island, but also the thing I kind of took away from it was it's this kind of eroding of the world before modernity. Because you look at this time, so it's the late 1800s, it's kind of the little bit early, but you're getting close into the Industrial Revolution, and the style of work from previous to now has just drastically changed in such a way that I think people are having to kind of come to the forefront of what is a job and what this job entails, and like what does modernity leave, or what is like this modern industrial mechanical life mean for me, for somebody who's been kind of this almost hunter and gathering small community member for so long. You just kind of get thrust into this system that is so predetermined and so mechanized. There's just this kind of, so it's kind of like these two men not only just butting up against each other because they're stuck on this remote island together, but also because it's like they're trying to figure out I think that there's just kind of this stark contrast between, you have a lot of these scenes where Robert Pattinson's character is like working in the bowels of the lighthouse with this machinery, and is having to crank and do all of this work, and that's kind of what begins the strife between these two characters, because Willem Dafoe's character is like, I'm gonna deal with the light, you deal with everything else. And so it's kind of an interesting, as this narrative goes along, Robert Pattinson's character just kind of craves this return to, I guess for lack of a better term, kind of like this return to the sea to an extent, rather than having to engage with these modern technologies. And I found that to be really interesting. And I think Eggers has just this obsession, whether that's good or bad for you, with language and detail to the period that completely sucks you in. I really appreciate it, but I can see where it can wear on other people. And friend of the pod, Chris Evangelista, said in his review for Twitter that this will not play well with modern audiences. And I think that A24, which has distributed both of Eggers' movies so far, should probably just realize that that dude does not play very well for modern audiences, because The Witch did not as well. So, yeah, I really enjoyed The Lighthouse. It should be coming out later this year. I guess this is the one that probably a lot of people will be curious to hear about. And, well, I'm going to save that one for a minute. Let me talk about Knives Out, because I actually like Knives Out. Knives Out is the latest movie from Rian Johnson. This is kind of his in-between. Similar to Taika Waititi, it's his in-between between two big-budget Star Wars movies. He did Star Wars The Last Jedi, and then now he's working on this trilogy of films that he's creating for Lucasfilm. So he made this very small but all-star packed cast of a kind of murder mystery whodunit. Just real quickly though, the plot, Christopher Plummer plays this, 80-year-old, famous mystery novelist who, beginning of the movie, I mean, this isn't spoiling anything, it's literally the first scene of the movie, is they find him in his study and his throat is slit, and, they rule it a suicide. But then you have this very famous detective played by Daniel Craig who comes in, who he can't figure out who hired him, but he's been hired to like investigate this as more of a murder. And you have all of these other faces. I mean, you have Jamie Lee Curtis, you have Chris Evans, you have Toni Collette, you have Michael Shannon, Lakeith Stanfield. Ana de Armas plays the kind of who becomes the central character of the narrative, as this nurse who worked with Christopher Plummer throughout the end of his life. But you have this all-star cast as this very greedy family who is trying to... Clearly they all had kind of complicated relationships with their father, Christopher Plummer, but... This is the movie. I've enjoyed most of Rian Johnson's work up to this point. I'm kind of a defender of The Last Jedi as being one of the more interesting, if not the most interesting, Star Wars movie of the whole saga. I'm kind of a sucker when it comes to when it comes to this one, when it comes to him as a director. But I really like this. Like, I think that you have that kind of cliche where it's like, oh, they don't make movies like this in the theater, blah, blah, blah anymore, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But I think this is a movie that like deserves, like, I think people should like go see, because I think it's a perfect, I mean, I was in a press theater and it was like very lively. People were getting into it. I can't even imagine what the public screenings were like, but I mean, it's a pretty funny movie. I mean, at the same time, it's smug, but I don't know. You get so sucked up. I think that he crafts the whodunit at the central point, and maybe it's because I haven't watched a lot of those recently, but I think that it's such a simple, it's just simple structure for a movie in like modern Hollywood, et cetera. And I don't want to sit here and just like wax poetic on the state of blockbusters and Hollywood discourse at the moment, but I think it's like a perfect, I'm surprised it's coming out so late, but especially when it's going to be a part of, it comes out in November as like this deluge of all of the different awards pictures and all of that kind of stuff. It's such a fun movie. It's such a, the cast, you know, it can go good or bad when the cast seems like they're all having a really, really fun time. And this cast seems like they're having a really fun time. And it's all these really eccentric performances. You see all of these people like Jamie Lee Curtis and Chris Evans and Toni Collette who kind of play this certain type of character for the most part of their career. I mean, they do have some diversity to it, but they play this kind of specific character for most of their career. And in this one, they're kind of playing off that or playing a little bit with that. And it's kind of fun to see. Like, I mean, Toni Collette literally plays this like embodiment of Gwyneth Paltrow. That's just fantastic. She has a quote near the beginning of the movie where she was like, oh my gosh, I saw a tweet of a New Yorker article that mentioned you. Which seems like, judging from like responses from people, they don't really like how relevant it is. This is a movie that actually has an extremely relevant political through line to it that I think that it could, you know, it's one of those things that it could not hit with anybody, but I think that at least for me, it was handled in a way that felt natural, that felt like it wasn't heavy-handed, that felt like it wasn't incredibly preachy. It just kind of was able to work that in organically because it's this movie about this very privileged, white, greedy family. And I think that the way that he handles that, Rian Johnson handles that, is really deft and interesting. So yeah, this is a kind of blockbustery type, you know, it's a movie with a bunch of movie stars. I think we, you know, it's always kind of nice to see those. It's the, you know, outside of the superhero realm, where this isn't like Avengers Endgame where it's all of these faces like who can't, you know, have to squeeze in a bunch of screen time. I think it's a well-paced, it's just a lot of fun. I don't really have too much more to say about it. Maybe, you know, I think once I write a review, maybe I can expand on it more nuancedly, but I think it's a movie that is perfect for like a movie theater experience. It's good to go see it with a big crowd. It's good to kind of all be there at the same time. And I think that it's a movie that's not going to break, you know, I think we get so stuck in, like, is this, like, breaking new ground? We're constantly, like, having to break new ground with stuff. Like, this has to be, the movie I'm about to talk about had to break new ground, you know? But it's, no, this isn't breaking new ground. This is what you would get from an Agatha Christie novel or something. But it's nice to see it. Like, it's not, like, it's just one of those, I'm glad that he made it in 2019. It's kind of fun to have, you know? It's not breaking new ground, but it's really great to have it. And it's done very well. And, yeah, Knives Out, it comes out in November. So I'll be curious to hear what other people say once it goes more wide. I really think that this is a movie that, it kind of reminds me of another Daniel Craig non-Bond movie, but it reminds me a little bit of Logan Lucky, which is this really entertaining, kind of perceptive movie that just completely flew under the radar and nobody really saw it in theaters. But it's a really great movie. And so I could see Knives Out being the same way, where it just flies under the radar, doesn't do much at the theater, and then it pops up on like Hulu or something. People are like, oh, this is a great movie. And you're like, yeah, this is when you know, you were in line to see, you know, the Holt Poops, you know, the Holt Poops, Scarlet Witch, you know, you missed this one. So that wasn't that clever. Speaking of stupid superhero movies, the other one I saw, this is a little bit more contested. This is The Joker, starring Joaquin Phoenix as the, Clown Prince of, I don't give a shit, Clown Prince of whatever himself. Takes place there in the 80s in Gotham. And he is a stand-up comedian who is trying to make it big, but of course, you know, life is just so hard, so difficult, and so chaotic, and so naturally, we just have to like lean into the chaos, I guess, is what this movie is telling you. This is such a strange, strange movie. It's directed by Todd Phillips, who I'm sure most people are familiar with his work as in the Hangover trilogy. So naturally, perfect person to take this on. I'm not saying that sarcastically. I mean, you can have like a cat direct a Marvel movie, so might as well give Todd Phillips a superhero movie to make. But I don't know. This is one that I'll probably expand on once we get a little bit farther. I don't feel like I have anything of interest to say that like people that hasn't already been said. I would encourage people to go and read a lot. There's a lot of great reviews coming out of TIFF and Venice on this movie. So I don't really think I have anything like earth shattering to say about it. I just, watching it, one, it's just not very well directed. The script is just terrible. Like, it's such a basic, boring script. It feels like it's written by like a high school kid who watched Taxi Driver and only latched on to the alienation point. Like, it just seems like that's who wrote it. Like, it's written like it's a high schooler. And Joaquin Phoenix, yeah, he's good because he's working with a script written by a high schooler. And so he has to do a lot to elevate that material. And I don't know what this movie's saying. Like, on the one end, you have this, like, they have the Joker, and you have the world is chaos, and the only way to fight back this chaos is to, like, lean into it and become a part of it and, like, harness it. And you also have, like, this part of the movie that is, like, anti-capitalist, that is like, you know, F the rich, the people need to rise up and be in charge. But also the movie is like saying that that's bad, and that actually that these people in power should be in power, but also the Jokers are like, it doesn't make, it's a that 12-year-old wrote it. I don't, it doesn't make any freaking sense. I don't know. I honestly, I'd be more curious to hear what Andrew has to say about it, because I think it plays a lot into his, it becomes somewhat, it pretty much becomes a horror movie, and it plays into his gun essay. And so I'd be curious to hear, I don't know. I think with this, I want somebody to bat off and, you know, kind of go back and forth with, but I just found it to be relatively, just incredibly loathsome. Like just the most like bargain, like the most basement level, like angsty college kid is going to put this poster up in his room. Like it's just such a, I just find him to be such an uninteresting, I don't see the whole appeal of the Joker. So that's coming out in a few weeks. I'm sure we'll talk about it on this podcast. I'll be curious. The last one I'll talk very briefly about also, which was one, honestly, out of the movies, all the movies that I saw at TIFF, I've been thinking a lot about it since I saw it, and that's Uncut Gems, and that's the latest by the Safdie brothers, who did Heaven Can Wait, but probably most people know them from their more wide release, Good Time, which brings back Robert Pattinson. And this one, I feel like the complaint with a lot of people about this one is going to be, it's just kind of a ripoff, not ripoff, but it's like a copy of Good Time, because it kind of follows the same beats to an extent. But I think that it's also a very interesting movie, and it's completely in a different realm. Like it's a very, I think they kind of divert in two different ways. So Uncut Gems stars Adam Sandler. He plays Howard Ratner, who is this jewelry store owner in New York. He also deals to like rich and famous people. Most pretty much for this movie, for this movie specifically, he's working with Kevin Garnett. That's set in like 2012. And so Kevin Garnett is in the midst of the Celtics run to the Eastern Conference Finals. They're playing the Philadelphia 76ers at the time. So you can already see, and so you can already see why I'm interested in this, but, so he gets this opal from, I think Ethiopia, if I remember correctly. So he gets this opal from Ethiopia where that like Kevin Garnett just like completely believes, like has this, is giving him this power because he like takes the opal for a day and then has like this insane game against the Sixers. And then when it's given back to Adam Sandler's character, he starts to like lose his groove in the game. So you have this storyline. Then you also have that Howard has all of these outstanding debts to these various people as they come and kind of shake him down and things like that. And then he also has this subplot with his girlfriend and who may or may not be having a affair with the, or at least a fling for one night with the Weeknd. Yes, the Weeknd is in this movie, but I don't know, it pretty much hits the beats of like a Safdie brothers movie. If you've seen Good Time or any of their other movies, I think that you're going to get the gist of what's happening in this one. But the thing that I was thinking about is just kind of how it's very similar to Good Time in the way that it kind of gives you this person who is very much boxed into this, just this set ways. And so, but he's a very different person from like the Robert Pattinson character in Good Time, who was not very well off with money. Like Howard Ratner, the Adam Sandler character, is fine. Like he's not just dripping in riches, but he's also fine. Like he's able to own an apartment in the city as well as, you know, have a house with his estranged wife played by Idina Menzel. But at the same time, he's just this person who's completely stuck in this machine of his own creation. Like he just can't help himself. He constantly is having to, like, whenever he gets like, he goes 2 points up, it's like he has to take the big shot and immediately fall 4 points. This is for NBA heads, but he's pretty much like the J.R. Smith of like the Diamond District of New York. Like it's like he starts going up, and you're like, oh, look at this, and he just takes a shot and it's, and he just falls like complete. And just watching that that constant ebb and flow is the Safdie brothers just do it in such a way that I think is so remarkable and so interesting. That, you know, it's Martin Scorsese executive produced this, and it's kind of cliche and boring to be like that they kind of have this, but I think that the thing that compares them to Scorsese is that Scorsese, regardless of how you feel about him, really understood New York at this period of a period of time when he was kind of there and within the culture, you know, with like Taxi Driver and Raging Bull and all of these different, you know, movies about New York during like the 70s and 80s and such. And I think that the Safdie brothers kind of have that as well. I mean, it's New York as well, but they understand this pocket of New York that so well, and I think that the way they're exploring it is like there's an empathy to Howard, but at the same time it's not like vindicating him. That they thread that line so in such a fascinating way. It's a movie that, like I said, I've been thinking a lot about it since I watched it. I was kind of like, oh, this, I enjoyed it a lot, but it wasn't nearly as good as like Good Time when I saw it. But then a couple days after, I'm just like, man, that was like, there was so much going on in that movie that I'm really excited. I kind of want to watch it again, having seen it before and kind of separating it more from Good Time. Cause I think I loved Good Time so much that there was such a connection there. And I think going in, you're like, oh, so it's the follow up to Good Time. It looks kind of similar. You got Adam Sandler in it. You know, you had all of these factors that kind of were in your head floating around that I'm excited to watch it a second time. Cause I think that it'll allow me to really separate it from all of those other factors and just be like its own thing. And I think it's one that will probably end up on, you know, as one of my best of the year lists, because it was fascinating to just be in that world for the 2 hour runtime or so. So Uncut Gems, I would recommend it, but oh my god, I've talked so long. So I'm kind of getting, as you can probably tell, I'm kind of getting burnt out on just talking. Well, we got a good chat though. We already recorded the part two for Do the Right Thing with Logan and Michael. And honestly, for three white people talking about race relations in America, I think it's probably the best case scenario that you can get. So after this short break, we're going to go to that. But yeah, stay tuned.
Hey, Cinematary listeners, Andrew here. During this break in the show, I'd like to mention that Cinematary does want your money. You can give us your money at patreon.com/cinematary, where you can chip in a small fee of about $5 a month, you know, the price of a fancy coffee, in exchange for shout-outs in every episode, the opportunity to choose movies we cover on the show, and bonus episodes every month in which we talk about more movies as well as other miscellaneous stuff. In the past, we've just been humbly asking for you to share the show and engage with us, and we would still love for you to do those things. You can tweet us at Cinematary, send us an email, zach@cinematary.com, leave us a review on iTunes, all that stuff. But Cemetery has grown a ton in the past few years due to the hard work of a bunch of writers, myself included, who haven't been paid for their labor, which is sadly a pretty normal thing. We record things and write things for free, you listen to and read them for free, and the only people getting paid are like Apple and Google, which is depressing. So, if you appreciate what we do, if you feel like there's some sort of value being exchanged here and you'd like more of it, help us normalize paying people by going to patreon.com/cinematary and chipping in $5 a month. We would truly appreciate it. Thanks for listening. Now let's get back to the show.
Back with part two of episode 264 of Cinematary. In this part, we'll be continuing our Young Critics Watch Old Movies series with 1989's Do the Right Thing, written and directed by Spike Lee. The film stars Lee, Danny Aiello, Ossie Davis, Ruby Dee, Richard Edson, Giancarlo Esposito, Bill Nunn, John Turturro, and Rosie Perez. Spike Lee first got the idea for the film after watching the Alfred Hitchcock Presents episode Shopping for Death, where the main characters discuss their theory that hot weather increases violent tendencies. He was also inspired by the Howard Beach racial incident and the shooting of Eleanor Bumpers, and wrote the screenplay in 2 weeks. The original script for Do the Right Thing ends with a stronger reconciliation between Mookie and Sal. Sal's comments to Mookie mirrored DeMayer's earlier comments in the film and hit at some common ground in perhaps Sal's understanding of why Mookie was motivated to destroy his restaurant. It is unclear why Lee changed the ending. Lee campaigned for Robert De Niro to play Sal, the pizzeria owner, but De Niro had to decline due to prior commitments. Real-life husband and wife Ossie Davis and Ruby Dee were friends of Spike Lee's father, Bill Lee, and were cast as mother-sister in DeMayer. Rosie Perez was cast as Mookie's love interest, Tina, after Lee saw her dancing at a L.A. dance club. Perez decided to take the part because her sister lived four blocks from the set. However, she had never been in a film before and grew upset during the filming of Radio Raheem's death scene. The film was released to protest from many reviewers, and it was openly stated in several newspapers that the film could incite black audiences to riot. Lee criticized white reviewers for implying that black audiences were incapable of restraining themselves while watching a fictional motion picture. In a 2014 interview, Lee stated, quote, "That still bugs the shit out of me. Outrageous, egregious, and I think racist. I don't remember people saying people were going to come out of theaters killing others after they watched Arnold Schwarzenegger films." The real-life incident that inspired Do the Right Thing happened in 1986 on December 19th when four black men, Michael Griffith, Timothy Grimes, Curtis Sylvester, and Cedric Satterford, were traveling when their car broke down. They walked 3 miles to the predominantly Italian-American Howard Beach neighborhood of Queens, where they got into an argument with some white teenagers before heading to New Park Pizzeria for a meal and a telephone. When they left the eatery, they were accosted by a larger group of white men, including the ones they'd encountered earlier. Satterford and Griffith were beaten. Griffith tried to run, but was chased onto the Belt Parkway, where he was hit by a car and killed. The incident was such a part of Do the Right Thing's DNA that Lee wanted to open the film with his character Mookie shouting Howard Beach while defacing Sal's famous pizzeria. Lee moved the filming from Paramount to Universal to avoid a sappy ending. Paramount executives dropped a bomb on Lee close to the end of pre-production, demanding an unrealistically uplifting ending. Quote, "They wanted Mookie and Sal to hug and be friends and sing We Are the World," told New York Magazine. "They told me this on a Friday. Monday morning, we were at Universal." Obviously, he did the right thing. Rosie Perez's dance sequence took 8 hours to film. The opening credits has her frenetic emotional dancing to the bowl-shaking bass boom of Public Enemies, Fight the Power, and it sets the stage as well for a lot of these Shakespeare's... Or you have moments like this that also set up for Shakespeare's prologues. Quote, "Spike didn't tell me he needed anger and angst and exhaustion. Instead, he just said, I need you to kill it. I thought I killed it in the first hour. Freaking 8 hours later, this freaking man had me still dancing. I had tennis elbow, my knee was swelling, so I forgot about the lyrics, the original words, you know, Elvis, John Wayne. To me, it was all spike, spike, spike. I hate you, I hate you, I hate you. And when rage and hate just poured out of my body, pure exhaustion, he went, cut, print, we got it." In 1989, the New York Times said, "In all of the earnest, solemn, humorless discussions about the social and political implications of Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing, an essential fact tends to be overlooked. It is one terrific movie." The New Yorker in 1989 said, "Most American movies just want to knock you senseless immediately and get it over with. Do the Right Thing tries to wear you down, and its strategies are fascinating." The Washington Post in 1989 said, "The movie runs on emotion, a highly questionable, highly flammable power source. Lee isn't a politician, and he doesn't censor himself or make sure that he has all his ideas worked out in his head first. He just tosses them out. As a result, the film is a moral workout." Roger Ebert in 1989 said, "Do the Right Thing is not filled with brotherly love, but it is not filled with hate either. It comes out of a weary urban cynicism that has settled down around us in recent years. The good feelings and many of the hopes of the 1960s have evaporated, and today it no longer would be accurate to make a movie about how the races in America are going to love one another." On that note, let's jump into Do the Right Thing, because naturally, to talk about this movie about race relations in America, we have three white guys and one of them in the UK. So none of us New York based, so we got this down, guys.
Yeah, this is very appropriate and insightful commentary over here.
I usually open asking if you've seen the film before. I feel like most people are probably aware of this one. It's celebrating a big anniversary this year and got a re-release on Criterion. So I guess to kind of kick it off, Michael, I'm going to start with you. What is your relationship to Do the Right Thing prior to talking about it for the podcast?
I mean, I love this movie. It was this first Spike Lee movie I saw. several years ago now, probably like 7 or 8 years ago. And I've revisited it since. It's a favorite of mine. I just think this movie is great, and we can like, that's like the least controversial take of all time at this point. But it is really striking, like hearing those reviews that you read, which like I always kind of intellectually know, like that's the response. But then to have just watched it the other day and then hearing, you know, those clips from the reviews is just really, really striking, because as I was watching it, I was thinking like, you know, obviously the politics are like central to the movie, but it is just such an enjoyable movie just on every single level, for me at least. And I've always felt this way. And I just think it's really great. It ticks a lot of my boxes for what I expect of, movies. And I mean, I honestly think it's like, if you told me this was the best movie of all time, like, I'm not sure if I would agree, but I would be like definitely okay with this being kind of the consensus pick for best movie of all time.
Yeah, no, and that's definitely something that I think we've heard, especially over the last few years, where a lot of the, at least when it comes to how people were kind of perceiving it when it first came out, has kind of withered away, and it's become kind of the iconic work of Spike Lee, whether that's good or bad for him, as he seems to be kind of a director who goes, much like the one reviewer says about his ideas, Spike likes to go all over the place, and so it's kind of difficult to just box him in into one movie, but it seems like this is the one that most people go to. Logan, what about you? What's your relationship with this movie prior to this?
Yeah, I first saw this movie when I was 10, I think. It was actually during a heat wave in Scotland, so that felt appropriate. It wasn't on purpose, since I didn't actually know it was about a heat wave, but it added to like the general ambiance around the viewing. It was late at night. It was like 2 a.m. when I started. I couldn't sleep. I had the living room to myself because my parents were gone. And they just left me because I had very responsible adult parents. So I was just sitting there, and I had like 20 DVDs laid out, and I was like, I'll watch Do the Right Thing because I heard so many great things about it. And I kind of got lost in the community of it, the community of the film, all the unique idiosyncratic characters, the amazing performances by pretty much everyone in the movie. And then I remember being kind of stunned by the ending. Like, it shocked me and horrified me and left me kind of, like, confused. Like, I wasn't quite sure what to make of it yet. And it was one of the first times of the movie where I'd ever had that kind of general confusion, needing to actually contemplate and think, especially at, like, a young age when I wasn't as much of aware of race relations in America. But every time I've come back to it, I've found new things to love. I've seen it maybe 4 times, including the watch I did earlier today. And it's just, there's something really special and human about it.
You're saying this, Logan, reminded me of actually the context when I first watched it, which was like right around the Trayvon Martin decision. Like when George Zimmerman was acquitted. So it was like, one of the reasons why I feel like, I mean, maybe we can get into this in a second, but one of the reasons why I feel like that this movie has had such a, like, I've never encountered anyone in the modern era who has an opinion like the Washington Post reviewer or the New York Times reviewer now, is that like the movie, like the truth of the movie kind of becomes undeniable after a certain, like, how many cycles of like this, basically Do the Right Thing happening in real life have to happen, you know, over and over and over again, you know, until everyone is kind of, you know, acknowledges, you know, you go on Letterboxd and like half of the reviews are like, I can't believe this was made 30 years ago. This happened, you know, this feels like it's happening today. And that's, I guess that's like kind of the point, is that it's this like accumulation of like the social tensions of like, you know, up to that point in 1989. And then like, as they've continued to play out in the 30 years since, where the movie itself is kind of undeniable. So I remember watching it, and Logan, I was kind of shook at the same point that you were too, except that my feeling was like, I was shook because I was like, holy shit, this is like what I am, you know, seeing happen in the news all the time now. Cause you know, not too long after that was then, you know, all the, you know, Michael Brown's murder and all that as well. So yeah, sorry. I just wanted to jump in with that context because I remembered that that was the context in that.
Yeah, I mean, which Michael Brown was, that was when Michael Brown died. That was when I rewatched it for the first time since, and I understood like perfectly what it was about, why the ending was the way it was, and it. Michael Brown's death was a turning point for me, even as like a white kid from Scotland. Like that when that happened, when I found that out, I was just distressed, and it kind of changed my whole views on the world and politics, and especially the police, which Do the Right Thing reiterates.
Well, and then I'm kind of glad that you're on this episode for that reason, because I want to talk a little bit about, because kind of working off the point you made at the beginning, Michael, I think that this is also a movie, if somebody was like, I need to learn about American culture, and they just wanted you to pass along like pieces of popular culture that could kind of inform you on how American culture operates, I think Do the Right Thing would be very much one of the first things you pass along to understand what American culture is like and how America works. And so as somebody not in America, I'm curious, I mean, how does this kind of shape your perception of the culture of the United States? Because I think that while it's very much a damning indictment on race relations, it also is something that it's cliche to say, like you were saying, Michael, but I mean, it's no different than it was in 1989. It's very much the same thing. So I'm kind of curious how your understanding of racial tensions, especially like in the United States, where I think it's much more highly publicized, was kind of informed by like watching this and gaining your understanding from this movie.
A quick thing I want to mention before getting into deeper racial elements is that it actually did kind of teach a sense of community before everything goes wrong. Like, it did actually recognize that people in neighborhoods in America, and especially in New York, actually have like close relationships with each other and like have character building, which isn't honestly as common over here anymore, since like systematic changes to cities in Scotland have kind of worked past like council tenements. Like, there's not as much of a community in where I grew up. Like, I barely knew any of my neighbors and I barely knew any of my local people. So it was kind of honestly staggering when I was younger to see like such a, I guess, developed sense of community relations. But for the racial aspect, it kind of taught me that racism wasn't just like the most blunt shit. Like, John Turturro's character is obviously very vocal and very like kind of the stereotype of active, willing racism. But like, it helped examine and show to me, even at a young age, that racism is more complex than a lot of schools teach it to be. A lot of like discourse around it is that people can be racist without necessarily intending to be, and that racism can be just as harmful, if not even more malicious, because it is the fundamental building blocks of America as a nation. And it just, it really, the thing that really stuck with me is that no matter how much they loved each other, how much they fought, there is still a limit to what they, just that these people in this small community could do to change things, because the greater world is just so large and so hateful towards Black Americans that it made me angry. Do the Right Thing was one of the first films that ever really made me angry about the world, especially when I understood all that, because it made me want to do more research and understand further and further. So it was actually kind of fundamental to my political beliefs. Which is, I'm sure Spike Lee would be very happy to hear that. But it didn't make me want to go to America. I'll put that out there.
It doesn't make us really want to stay, so that's fair. Go ahead, Michael.
I was going to say, I think one of the, this time watching it, what struck me is one of the key scenes kind of connects to something you were talking about, Logan, about how, like, the different, permutations of racism. And there's that scene where Sal and John Turturro's character, his son in the movie, are like sitting there talking in front of the window, and John Turturro is basically like, why do we have to work, like, why is our shop in this part of town? And Sal is like, oh, I love, you know, this part of town's great, you know, I love these people, and you know, they love my food. And like, there's this kind of back and forth where like Sal is like waxing like you know, very affectionately toward like the neighborhood. And like, that's such a striking thing that like, you see how he perceives himself in relation to the neighborhood there, where he kind of views himself like paternally almost to the neighborhood. 'Cause he talks about like seeing the kids grow up and things like that. And it's very sweet, but then you contrast that with like his outward like actions and an attitude toward the people in the town, you know, like obviously like right about Rahim, but then also toward, I'm forgetting the guy's name, but the guy who wants the black folks picture on the wall. Bugging out. Right. And so, you know, he's like outwardly very like aggressive toward them when they at all like challenge his status quo. And so like Sal has this kind of interior monologue that we get in that one scene in the middle of the movie where he like imagines himself as being part of the community, and he is part of the community, but he's like, as the movie goes on, you see like the dissonance between how he thinks he's part of the community and then how he's really part of the community, until it obviously culminates in, you know, the ending.
Well, real quickly, it really speaks to like the modern idea of, or at least the friction that comes up with the modern idea of community, because it seems like for the longest time, like humans have viewed, you know, we were all separated into these like small villages all across the world, that seems this like still be our mindset. And watching it this past, for this episode now, I was thinking about how this also works within this idea of different, of how a lot of tension is from 1989 to before that to, you know, even today, a lot of tension comes from the fact that I don't think we as humans were set up to have such nuance to our community necessarily. Like, you look at this, and yes, Sal is definitely a part of the community in the fact of like Brooklyn and this block, but there's also this variety of different kind of pods of community within that, because you have African American people living there, you have Italian American people living there, you have I forget if they were from, I think Korea or China. I think you have the Korean family who is there. You even have, you have that one scene where the guy, there's the white guy, I think in a Larry Bird shirt, which just kind of encapsulates it. I thought that was a really nice touch.
And he's biking. The guy's gotten off of his bike.
The biker who comes in and he's like, no, I live here. Like I own a house here and everything. And so you have, so like the sense of community has kind of lost its meaning from just being like this kind of small village of people that you're interacting with constantly and that you have, that you rely on for so many things. And it's become so fractured and kind of nuanced to a way that it seems like we as humans don't really know how to compute that. And this is in 1989, not even factoring in like what it would be like, what it is like today with like the onslaught of the internet. And so that was one of the things that I was picking up on this most recent viewing, is that, yeah, like to your point, Sal sees himself as a part of the community, but community does not mean what he thinks it means, because while he may be a part of this neighborhood, as you can see, as people start tearing down his shop, he is very much not the figure of the community, of the community that's predominant in this neighborhood, as he'd like to think. But Logan, sorry I interrupted you.
No, I was just going to say that kind of Sal is kind of like the arbiter of like democratic woke liberals, in that like they try so hard to seem accepting and understanding of people that aren't like them, but they refuse to accept any substantial changes that might directly affect their positioning or the way people view them. Spike Lee really got ahead on that. But to bring up to your point about community, honestly, it kind of feels like Spike Lee, he felt the kind of like, you know, Do the Right Thing's kind of got scale for a movie of its size. Like, it is very lofty. It's all about characters in this community. Like, there's like at least a couple dozen named people in the film. And it reminded me, when you said a community, was Crooklyn, which he made a few years later, which kind of is in a similar setting as Do the Right Thing, but it makes it more interior. It focuses on very small element of characters and very mostly about this family with only a few people. Like, Jerry from Twin Peaks is the next door neighbor who, fucks with them the whole time, and just other kids around the block. But it is all about these few people. And I think Spike Lee does believe in the power of community and the power of, like, especially black communities coming together. And I think that's even evident in Do the Right Thing, where a sense of community is forged through something horrible, where they unite together gradually. I think he is a believer in not just explicitly black community, but in a community that actually looks after everyone. I think he's an optimist in that sense. And I think Do the Right Thing on this viewing, honestly, kind of, it's horrifying and brutal and disgusting to think about this still happening. But there is this kind of tangible sense of optimism in, like, even just Mookie, who is a very timid guy, just liberating himself from his anxieties and his stresses and just trying to do something. People uniting together to try and do the right thing. And I think there's something really beautiful about that.
Well, you also have that kind of, and he exemplifies that in the last moments, but you have this kind of push and pull between the ideologies of Martin Luther King and the ideologies of Malcolm X, who, I guess from a bird's eye, if you wanted to go way, way up, you can see, oh, they're kind of trying to accomplish the same thing. But at this, but if you look much more deeply at the at their talkings and writings and et cetera, they've very much went about their path in different senses. And so I feel like that also kind of comes into play of, are you going to go about this in the way of, like, of how Reverend Martin Luther King would do it, or are you going to be in a much more aggressive, you know, I guess much more, not really aggressive, but much more tangible fashion in the, like, in Malcolm X's sense, where you're going to go and actually have to, you know, do something much more visible rather than just kind of speaking and trying to get to people on that spiritual level.
I think Spike is honestly trying to make a film that achieves both. Like, to,
oh, he is 100%.
Blend the ideologies of Luther King and X, both absolutely visionary men in very different and very similar ways, obviously. I mean, even going to the fact that 3 years after this, he made arguably his best film, Malcolm X, which I think also comes to play. That's a film also about community. Like, it's all about the people around Malcolm that helped make him who he is. It's a very ideology direct film, obviously, Do the Right Thing. Like, it is about trying to find your place as a black American and about trying to find an ideology in a world that is built on your oppression, built on slavery, built on racism. And the thing about Do the Right Thing is what makes it so brilliant is that it doesn't have any easy answers. There is no clear, overwhelming message at the end to try and preach to you. It shows you a complex, horrible situation, shows you how people to react to it, and leaves you to try and make up your own mind and try and attach what you've learned here into the real world, into your real world thinking. And that is considerably more effective in, like, a storytelling and a, like, political way than just being told. I love this movie.
Well, I think, you mentioned Malcolm X too, and Malcolm X in a way almost has the same, a similar effect, like that movie, especially being based on, like, Alex Haley's, like, you know, or the Alex Haley dictated autobiography of Malcolm X, which is that, like, that movie and then the book that it's based on isn't, like, Malcolm is a consistently changing ideology in that movie and in real life, you know, like, he, you see him, like, his own ideas are in tension with one another, in a way that, like, you know, Do the Right Thing really, like, lampshades by having the two opposing, juxtaposed quotes at the end. And I feel like that's, like, a real project, is that, Spike Lee is intentionally, like, bringing up these conflicts and basically saying that in the same way that, like, an American community, or really the American project in general, is, like, a collection of what would seem like irreconcilable conflicts, whether those are based on community and race or ideology, and the whole, like, American project's success is hinging on whether or not that juxtaposition and that tension can exist in a constructive way. And, like, Do the Right Thing is, like, this whole, like, pressure cooker of, like, can a, can battling ideologies and, self-segregating communities and people who are oppressing one another, like, is there a way to make something constructive out of that or not? And I just think it's so beautiful because of that. You know, I don't know, like, the early goings, like, I mean, I agree with you, Zach, about how, like, his version of community is, like, in some way cynical because it's expressing, like, the ways in which, like, communities break down because of, you know, the way that society has been run for so long. But at the same time, like, you know, at least the first half of the movie probably is just, like, this, like, whirlwind, like, encapsulation of what a community is. And you're kind of, you know, there are conflicts and everything, but everything just is so alive. And there, within the conflicts, there are, like, these kind of grace moments and moments of collaboration and everything that, like, ultimately don't last in the movie. But, like, while it does last, it's kind of beautiful and bewildering until, you know, in retrospect, you see the kind of simmering, escalation of things. But I think the movie, like, feels very optimistic at times about, like, the possibility of, like, a community like this, even if, like, that doesn't get realized within the movie by the end.
Well, it's so complicated to, like, to keep that going for the entire, I mean, not much, much less the entire runtime, but, like, just keep that going for an extended period of time, because I think it requires so much thought and humbleness and kind of transparency to kind of realize, like, what's happening and how you were supposed to see this in a way that's not just from your own point of view, but from others' from other points of view. And so it starts with this concept of community that I think is great to see, because it has this aliveness. It has just this texture that you have all these different personalities all kind of melting together. It's like the perfect encapsulation of how people describe New York and describe the American dream. But then it also, you also see what also makes America what it is. And that's how as tensions rise and as things continue to erode and erode and erode that whole system, it easily, you know, devolves into the most primal emotions. And I think that that's one of the fascinating things about this movie is the way that it's able to, and I think it gets to that without feeling preachy. You know, it's not like it doesn't feel like a movie that's Logan, I think you mentioned it before, but it's not like a movie that's just kind of like handing you with, like, this is how you're supposed to, this, you know, this, you know, it's not Green Book solves racism this way.
That's,
you know, it's
what,
not,
I was
like
gonna say as well, I was gonna say Green Book. Yeah,
it's not like it's giving you a playbook on how to solve racism. Instead, it's just going, this is how complicated it is to maneuver modern life and just modern humanity. And so it gives you these two schools of thought from MLK and from Malcolm X, and it's like these two guys have these two theories on how this works, but we don't know which one is the right one, and that's kind of up to you. But at the same time, you have to, like, deal with the complexity of just a modern society. And I think that's what the way that it really kind of speaks to that is, I think even in 1989 was well above its time, and I think still is well above its time now in 2019.
Well, and it's like not just modern society, but there's, like, this rich sense of, like, history, both on, like, a metaphorical level and, like, a literal level. You know, like, we have the, you know, Sal's kind of monologue at the end about how he built his shop with his bare hands. And then, like, you get, like, these senses from the, like, different generations of people who have lived in the neighborhood about, like, how their perception of, like, you know, the neighborhood changing and all that. And, like, the entire, like, you know, diversity of the neighborhood is, like, America kind of founded on, like, you know, like a fatal premise. You know, I mean, the whole reason Sal is there is that he's there profiting off of this neighborhood. I mean, the whole reason why there are African Americans in America, you know, the reason why they're not just, you know, Africans still in Africa is that people were literally profiting off of their bodies. And now in the modern day, we have to build a community out of that, like, from that premise. And, you know, it's obviously, like, Sal's relationship to the community is not, like, literally, like, slavery, but it's still an exchange of a kind that, like, you know, in a lot of ways makes him feel like superior, right? You know, this is my place, Italian Americans on the wall, not, you know, African Americans on the wall. And the commercial aspects of it, is kind of the premise of him being there, and it's also kind of what undoes it as well. And so to try to make a community out of that, you know, is just a really fascinating and complicated and thorny idea that I think the movie navigates really well.
Well, and the movie doesn't, you know, it definitely doesn't have time to like to get into this, but it'd be interesting to see what that block was like when Sal and his family like initially moved there, because I think it also kind of grazes. It doesn't really like have enough time to like really inspect this, but it grazes on the fact that, I mean, Sal is an Italian and an Italian American, and probably 50 to 60 or somewhat years before the events of this movie, he would very much be kind of the minority view of a lot of what the decision making in America is. And one of the things I was thinking about while just kind of seeing him and the John Turturro character and kind of how they're reacting to things is this writing that I've been checking out about like different groups who have quote unquote become white. So you have like Italian Americans, and you have Catholics, and you have Irish Catholics, and you have all of these different groups that have found a way to kind of get themselves accepted into white societies in order to kind of take off the burden of that stigma of being this kind of minority group in a white dominated country, but also, you know, giving up all of that culture and heritage from before and kind of assimilating into whiteness in order to get some of the privileges and some of the rights and some of the American dream principles that white Americans get. And I was thinking about that. So as he like kind of wants to be a part of this community, at the same time, this is at a point where you look at that wall of Italian American heroes that he has, and you're like, a lot of those people aren't of the same ilk as the Italians coming through Ellis Island, you know, during that period of time. Like these, like Frank Sinatra is a pretty mainstream white figure of a person. He's not like, you know, this kind of minority figure. And so I think that's something I was also thinking about, is just this concept of becoming white and kind of the assimilation into that other cultures have taken in America in order to kind of get those privileges and get that authority as being a white American.
Well, and you assimilate into the racism as well, you know, by becoming white, he also becomes part of, you know, white privilege and the white establishment that, you know, oppresses people of color.
I think there's a major dichotomy in Sal's character, which makes him really fascinating, is that throughout the movie, he's trying to position himself as this kind of arbitrary patriarchal figure of authority. Like, he wants to be kind of not a definitive figure of control, but he wants to be the person that is the figurehead of the community. But he also wants to be viewed as oppressed. Like, he wants to be part of these marginalized people. He wants to be part of their community. He wants to both control them and be one of them. And he is grappling with the idea of, how do I be both? And that eventually causes his story to get destroyed, because he is not either, and he is trying to be. Instead of accepting that he is different than them and reckoning with his privileges, despite the fact that he might have grown up in a time where he was oppressed for being Italian, instead of growing, he has decided to remain stagnant and believe that he is being generous for his ideological viewpoints. And that makes him sinister character to me.
Right, because he's not just stagnant, but he makes... You know, the two big moment, or I guess the one big moment of, like, you know, active, forward motion on Sal's part is destroying, you know, Radio Rahim's boombox, you know, which is a moment of violence. You know, his final act of, like, non-passivity is an act of oppression, you know, which is kind of the choice he ends up making. That's the side he lands on, is the side of the cops and the side of, you know, racism, definitively.
Like, even, like, just the way, like, he speaks to, like, bugging out, like, there's this kind of, like dripping sense of condescension there. Like, not just, like, because of the Italian-American thing, but you can just tell from his, like, positioning and his poise that he just views him as lesser. Like, there's just this kind of subtle feeling of just, he doesn't think they're of the same brethren.
There's that line where Bugginot asks him how much the slice of pizza is, and Sal's like, you come in here 3 times a day. And I feel like as a business owner, that would be a good thing that you have a loyal customer. But the way he says it is this, like, definitely, like you said, Logan, like, condescension that, like, you eat pizza 3 times a day, you know, you are somehow lower, you know, that the fact that you come in here 3 times a day.
Like, he wouldn't treat a white customer the way he treats Bugginot. That's undisputed. Like, the...
Since we're kind of on the subject of Sal's, especially of Sal's treatment of different characters, I'm curious real quickly what you made of, like, because they do make a point of that whole sequence where he's talking with, I forgot her name, but Mookie's sister, who comes into the pizza shop, and it's interesting how he talks and interacts with her, and the way that his sons and Mookie kind of look at that. And he even makes a point to, like, say, hey, you need to leave my sister alone. What did you make of that whole interaction?
I mean, I see that interaction all the time where there's, not to paint too broadly, but, like, you know, just kind of a cantankerous old men who treat, you know, kind of attractive younger women, like, they soften for that. And, you know, I think that that obviously has some sort of root in, like, a gendered and sexual dynamic there, and that's clearly how, like, Mookie does it. I don't think he's really trying to, like, hook up with her, but I think that there's, like, that subtext there that he is, you know.
There's that subtext of, like, interest there that I am horribly ill-equipped to, like, speak to, like, the whole pretext and context of, like, black bodies, especially female black bodies, and the gaze of especially established white men that I'm not even going to try. But I think I would love to hear somebody's perspective on that, because I think that you could speak a lot to just that. Because, yeah, it doesn't seem like there's an intention to act on it, but there is just this gaze and infatuation that clearly swells over him that makes everybody there, including his sons, kind of weary of his, you know, affection toward her.
And he knows he can get away with it. He knows that he can be leering, be condescending, be kind of, like, sexual without any direct intent, just like a kind of overwhelming sense of creepiness. He knows that there is no repercussions that can be gained that will harm him or harm his standing, particularly because she is a black woman and people don't tend to believe black women in America. They are frequently silenced, even in 2019, it clearly not listened to. The standing of a white man in authority with a stance in the community over her, just feeling uncomfortable with flirtation, he knows that he has power over her, and whether intentionally or not, he is utilizing it against her and against basically everyone in the movie. He utilizes a form of power against, but I think it's clear in any interaction he has with women that there isn't really a respect there. I think his relationship with Mookie is very uncomfortable as well. I think that is just, like, he is viewing him as a body. And Mookie...
And he views it as, like, a father-son thing. Like, it's... Like, he's kind of his heart... Like, he's his father, he loves him, but he's hard on him, and it doesn't... Yeah. At the same time, he seems very disposable.
I think Mookie,
to Sal.
I think Mookie wants to believe that it's a father-son thing, because he does seem to genuinely care about Sal. I think he wants to believe in it, but I think there is that doubt, and that doubt that gets reinforced as the film goes on and on, that he is in a kind of, like... a family of his own creation that can be just as harmful as the family he was given from birth.
Well, yeah, like, I mean,
this is not a healthy dynamic for him.
Yeah, I mean, it goes back to the point I was making that you can have this community in place and feel like everything is working correctly, but at the same time, there's just that erosion that takes place. And so I think Mookie, yeah, goes, this is somebody who I see as kind of this paternal figure, but at the same time, if something turned and he, I guess, you know, it's literally in the most primal terms, if something turned and he was some animal that needed to leave, he would immediately leave him. He wouldn't stay and make sure he was okay. And so I think that at that point when he goes and throws that trash can through the window, it's like this clarity that he's going, this guy, I care about this guy, and he's done right by me to an extent, at least giving me a job and giving me a steady paycheck, even though it's not great. But at the same time, I'm deeply disposable to him. And that was clear just through that whole interaction that led to him throwing the trash can.
He's never his flesh and blood, and he is always made to remember that. He is always conscious of it.
That final scene between them, when Sal at first is going to give him, like, what is it, like $600 or something like that, and then Mookie has to give all that money back, because, like, Sal's essentially just, like, paying him off is the wrong term, but Sal is, you know, exchanging, you know, something about Mookie for money. And I think that when Mookie, you know, gives part of the money back at first, that's like a key component, like a key fracture in the relationship, is that moment when Sal is going to, in some way, like, whether it's paying for the previous day or just, like, in some way, like, you know, paying Mookie to go away or what, you know, whatever Sal is doing there, like, the fact that it hinges on money, and Mookie kind of recognizes that, is, you know, is kind of the, you know, a real breaking point.
It's really, especially, like, a lot of people have given Spike shit as an actor for his various performances. I like him.
He's good in this movie.
He's not the strongest performance in the film by any means, but he's good. But in this scene in particular, he really stands out. It's his best work as an actor. The look in his eyes, it's heartbreaking. Like, even as a kid, and as an autistic person, like, I was very bad at eye stuff and, like, body language. Like, watching a lot of movies helped me understand facial expressions, but at the time I was kind of alien to it. And even then, even in, like, 2019, even, like, whatever year it was I watched this for the first time, even then I got that kind of tangible sadness just from looking at his eyes. And I think that's a really, really good performance. I think my favorite is still Giancarlo Esposito, though. I think he is absolutely incredible in this movie.
He's just on such a, like, he hits that one level, and he's consistent. He never, like, wavers from it. It's kind of great. I think the same could be said about Bill Nunn as Radio Raheem. Like he just, I think he stays at such a steady level. And so then I think that helps with the escalation near the end, because you've seen this kind of steady presence for so long that once he, like, shows any reactive emotion or reacts in any way, like, you know, it's serious. Like, it's such a simple narrative device, but it's so effective at that point.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a kind of tangible connection I feel to Radio Raheem, despite our extensive differences, in that, like, he has got this primal connection to his boombox. Like, he has this thing that gives him purpose. A lot of people might not understand it, but this object gives him meaning, gives him life, gives him soul, makes him feel like life is important and beautiful. And then when it's destroyed, like, what has he got left? Like, there's nothing left. And then obviously what happens to him is just heartbreak. But, like, seeing the boombox break, like, as an autistic person, I've got, like, an attachment to a lot of inanimate objects as well. Like, there is, like, this importance we place on something that isn't technically alive but feels so seismic. So, like, when the boombox smashed, I had to look away. Like, I couldn't see it. It felt like gutturally devastating, especially knowing that it is, like, the catalyst to everything. Like, it made me, like, tear out. That was the moment when I started crying, and I did not stop until, like, 5 minutes after the movie ended. I think it's a really special performance, and I think Lee's consistent, like, empathy to a kind of oddball character like Radio Raheem, like, his consistent compassion and depth he provides to him is one of the reasons why he's one of my favorite filmmakers, because he has that approach to many of his kind of more weird and oddball characters throughout his filmography.
Definitely. Well, I think that's a good note to wrap up on. So, Do the Right Thing, it's pretty widely available. Like I said at the beginning, the Criterion Collection just put a new release of it out. But if you have not seen this, I you know, please, like, go ahead and just turn this podcast off right now and go seek it out and find a way to watch The Right Thing. Because yeah, it's been relevant since the day it came out. And even before. So, yeah, I recommend, I'm glad we were able to get to this, finally on the podcast. But that will wrap up this episode of Cinematary. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/cinematary, on Twitter at @cinematary, and on Letterboxd at letterboxd.com/cinematary, where we post all the movies that we talked about in this episode. Next week, we will be finally concluding our Young Critics Watch Old Movies series. It's been a very long summer into fall, which if you live in the southeast part of the United States, it just feels like summer all the time, so it really had no change. But we're going to conclude with 1986's A Better Tomorrow. Yes, this is the first John Woo movie that we're covering in a series for Cinematary, so I assume Nathan will be here. I haven't checked the schedule. I assume he's coming. So
did I put myself on that one?
I feel like you'll be here too. I feel like it'll be like we're just gonna step back and Logan and Nathan are gonna handle the second part of that episode. So
we're just gonna cry the whole time.
And I forgot to mention, I mentioned at the top, but I'll mention again. We got some great we have some great writing on the website. Some new writers to check out. We have a review by Nick Armstrong of Extremely Wicked, Shockingly Evil and Vile, the Ted Bundy's movie that stars Zac Efron. We have a review of Parasite, which we didn't catch at TIFF, but was really the hot ticket there, the new Bong Joon-ho movie. Lucy Palmer wrote a review for us. She saw it at Cannes. And then our own Logan Kinney wrote about Angel Has Fallen and talks about Gerard Butler and all of his features and glories in his in kind of his late part of his career. So check that out. Those are all on cinematary.com. And thank you to our patrons who helped to help give our writers some kind of thank you for all the hard work they put into it. You can join on patreon.com/cinematary. And so thank you to Cam, Chad Newsom, Chris Metcalf, Eric Dukowski, Graham Jones, Harry Eskin, Maggie, Marie Barty, Matthew Lingo, Miranda Barnwall, Ron Hayes, Tyler Chandler, and Whitney Rio Ross. Thank you so much. But yeah, look forward to next week. Thank you guys for listening, and we will see you then.